friends, we will be starting our today's class. Dividend policy we have started and one model we have covered. So we'll be continuing our class. Let me share with you the relevant screen. Just wait a minute. I think you are able to see the screen. Screen is visible to you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, so yeah, I think it is quite clear now. So we have initiated the topic. We have understood what is the meaning of dividend. We know when you talk about the dividend, we are talking about the split between the profit, the split of profit, that how much money is to be retained by the company, how much is to be distributed. That is in fact the dividend decision or dividend policy. We have discussed the various types of dividend policy. This is the list we have already discussed individually, this kind of dividend policies. What are the determinants of dividend policy? These concepts we have completed our discussion in that regard. Types of dividend we have discussed. Right. So these are broadly various kinds of dividend theories, but finally we have decided that we will be studying only these three theories. Okay, and we will classify these theories into two parts. One is dividend relevant theory and dividend irrelevant theory. That means the theories which believe that the dividend payment, dividend declaration has an impact on the valuation, the value of the firm. And the theory which believes that the dividend declaration or dividend policy doesn't have any impact on the value of the firm. Okay, under dividend relevance theory, we are getting two theories, Walter model and Gordon's model, and dividend irrelevant theory, MM approach or MM
model. MM approach.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Right. So other theories we are not studying, only these three theories. Walter model we have covered in our previous class. What are the assumptions? And here this formula, you wanted that formula, we need to repeat. This is the formula. Mr. Walter said that the price of the share depends upon two things. One thing you see dividend, second part is the retained earning. And this retained earning will be subjected to growth. Okay, this part, the retained earning, that is earning minus dividend, EPS minus DPS,
yes, sir,
will grow at that rate. Okay, and the entire thing, that means, yes, dividend has to be capitalized, that means dividend has to arrive at the present value, that has to be discounted, and this earning also has to be discounted to arrive at the present value. The discount factor is KE. Okay, so what Mr. Walter says,
yes,
that the price is a function of dividend as well as the retained earning. And therefore, you say, you see, dividend is relevant. Dividend is very much relevant. Is it not? That is the formula. Meghna,
yes,
you understood it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And again, if you apply that formula, and for the practical application, he has divided the firms of the companies into three parts. What are these three kinds of firms he is calling? Can you recall? Can you read it?
Growth firm. No.
Normal firm, declining firm.
Yeah, growth firm, normal firm and declining firm. Growth firm means when R is more than K, normal firm is when R is equal to K, and declining firm is where R is less than K. Accordingly, he has said growth firm should pay less dividend. Less dividend means it should pay zero, and declining firm should pay maximum dividend. That means 100% they should share. And if it is a normal firm, it is indifferent. Any kind of dividend or any dividend can be paid at any ratio. Therefore, we are calling this theory as, what we are calling this theory?
All or none theory.
Either distribute all profit or nothing. Okay, identify what kind of firm it is. It is a growth firm, a normal firm, or declining firm. Accordingly, you decide how much dividend has to be paid. Okay, then for explaining the formula,
yes, sir,
I divided that formula into two parts. Okay, that means dividend by KE or R by KE multiplied with E minus D divided by K, that is present value of retained earning, yes, and present value of dividend. This concept also we have.
Dividend.
Okay, some textbook, yes, also says instead of E minus D, they say EPS minus DPS. That is also same thing, is it not?
Yes.
If you understood the concept, yes, any kind of, with any kind of data like this, we'll be able to solve that question. And this question you have solved yesterday perfectly without any error. That's nice. Questions you have completed. Okay, now criticisms also we have covered, theoretical part we have already covered. And today, we are going to start this another theory, and this is again a dividend relevance theory. That means this theory also believes dividends are relevant, and this is also something similar to our previous theory. Gordon's theory also, by and large, has got a lot of similarity with our Walter's theory. Okay, but what Gordon says,
yes, sir,
that the what is market price? Market price is the present value of the future dividends. Here he is not considering about the retained earning part, right? Walter was considering two parts: present value of the future dividends as well as
what? Present value of retained
earning. Present value of the retained earning. Okay, and here their assumption was something different. Like so many assumptions are there, like dividends are constant, all these kind of assumptions are there. Here also we'll be getting this set of assumptions, we'll decide. Okay, but here,
yes,
if you see what Mr. Gordon says, that dividends are assumed to grow. Is it not different? Gordon's model mein kya tha? Dividends are constant. Earnings are constant, dividends are constant. Is it not? Is it not? Therefore, in the formula,
yes,
use the D by K. That means dividend is constant, no? That means today's dividend is equal to next year's dividend is equal to next to next year's dividend. D0 is equal to D1 is equal to D2, like this. But here, we have to assume dividend is growing. Okay. Dividends are assumed to grow at a uniform rate. And he suggests that the market price of the share will be the present value of the growing perpetuity. Okay. When we are learning this capital budgeting chapter, in the context when we are discussing the concepts of time value of money, we have understood what is a growing perpetuity. That means it's a kind of cash flow which will grow forever. Is it not? And there we have understood that how to compute the present value of growing perpetuity. If you remember, the formula was present value of the growing perpetuity was something like this: perpetuity,
yes sir,
divided by time value of money minus growth rate.
Growth rate.
Okay.
Yes sir.
So, okay, present value of perpetuity is equal to perpetuity divided by TBM minus growth rate. Okay.
Yes,
same thing, since the growing perpetuity, what is the present value of perpetuity? We are calling it P0. P0 is the present value of perpetuity. Okay, perpetuity is a dividend,
yes,
D1. TBM is time value of money is KE, and growth rate is growth rate. So the same formula is converted into this formula. Okay, that means present value of perpetuity formula, that which we have learned in the chapter time value of money. Okay, and the same formula is converted in this dividend policy chapter in a different way. The same formula is presented so that we will be able to compute the market price of the share. Right? Market price of the share is also the present value of the growing perpetuity. Okay. Now, can you recall the formula? Can you remember the formula? P0 is equal to D1 by?
D1. KE minus growth rate.
KE minus G. Okay. That is the concept. He says the present value, that means the share price are the function of present value of all future dividends. And to prove that formula, he has taken a list of assumptions. Okay, one by one, let us read these assumptions. Some of you please read these assumptions one by one. I will be explaining. Assumption one.
The farm is an all.
Farm is an all equity.
The farm.
Yeah, please read it.
Yes, sir.
All equity.
The farm is an all equity farm. There is no debt.
That means there is no debt.
And the second one.
Only equity share, yes, capitals, sir, are there. That is his assumption. Okay. Now, second is.
Yes, sir. There is no outside financing and all investment are financed exclusively by retained earning.
Okay. That means there is no fresh equities are also issued. Only internally we will manage the finance. First of all, there is no debt.
Yes, sir.
There is no new issue of equity shares also. That means if the company wants to do some,
yes,
investment, what it can do? It can use its retained earning. Okay, retained earning,
yes,
is the internal finance. So company has to use internal finances. There is no outside finance.
Yes.
This is the second assumption.
Yes,
third assumption.
Internal rate of return of the farm is constant.
R is constant. So farm's rate of return is constant.
Yes,
fourth.
cost of capital of the farm also remain
K
same
is
regardless
also
of.
K is remains same regardless of the risk and regardless of the complexity involved in that farm. So R is constant,
yes, sir.
K is constant. Next.
It's constant. The farm derives its earning in perpetuity.
Huh. Farm's earnings are earned in perpetuity. That means over a fairly long period of time, farm continues to earn forever. 6 point.
Yes, sir. The retention ratio once decided upon is constant. Thus, the growth rate of farm is also constant.
So, retention ratio is constant. Growth rate is also constant.
Yes, sir.
And you already know how to compute growth rate. If you know the retention ratio,
yes,
and you know the farm's rate of return, you know G is equal to B into R. We have already understood that concept. Okay.
Yes,
okay. Now, next assumption is?
Cost of capital is greater than the growth rate.
Yes. Capital means here there is only equity is there. There is no debt. So, cost of capital is more than the
yes.
growth rate. Okay. Okay. That is one more assumption.
Yes, sir.
Cost of capital is more than the growth rate. Now.
Corporate taxes do
yes.
not exist.
There is no taxation. Next is?
So, why?
This is an assumption. With that assumption, we will be able to prove or we will be able to find out that which kind of farm should give, so which kind of farm should adopt what kind of dividend policy. But you can say this is an unrealistic assumption because taxes are possible. But if you want to incorporate tax, then what will happen? Our shareholders' earnings will be different. Okay, to avoid that kind of complexity, we are assuming that there is no tax. Or you can say Mr. Gordon has assumed there is no tax. Okay.
Sir, but equity mein to tax exist hota hai na. Debt mein nahi hota.
Tax exist hota hai matlab equity mein kuch tax exist nahi hota. Okay. Equity mein kya tax? But when that equity generates some income, that may attract some kind of taxes for the investors.
Yes, sir.
Is it not? Here assumption is there is no tax. That means investors earning is whatever investors will earning that is tax free. For example, let us say, suppose you are earning a dividend of 100 rupees. We will assume that 100 rupees is your total income. But suppose we will say tax is there. Tax is there means suppose you are at 30% tax law. So for you, earning is not 100, earning is 70. Is it not? But let's say another shareholder. Another
yes,
shareholder who is not in 30% slab. He is in 5% slab. For her, same dividend 100 rupees is paid to him, but he is getting 95. For him, income is 95.
90.
Because tax rates are different. Okay, so like this, to avoid all this kind of complexities, here he has assumed there is no tax rate. Okay, so
yes,
that we can say shareholders' incomes are uniform. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes,
right.
Sir.
Now, next point number 9.
Retention ratio is always less than 1.
Yeah. Retention ratio is always less than 1. That means B, the retention ratio is always 1. That always less than 1. Okay, that is again one more argument.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that means 100% retention is not there. Something has to be paid. Next. 10.
All earning are either retained or distributed immediately.
Retained. Whatever money is earned, that may be retained by the farm or that may be distributed. Okay. With these assumptions, we will now try to understand this theory. Okay. I have already told you the formula. What is the formula? Can you recall? P0 is equal to D1 divided by KE minus G.
KE minus G.
Different textbooks write this the same formula in different ways. Another way of explaining the formula is like this. I told you what D1 divided by KE minus G.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Same
yes,
formula.
Sir.
I can say what is D1 means dividend. What is dividend? Dividend is equal to earning multiplied with 1 minus retention. Suppose retention is 30%. So dividend will be How much? 60%.
60%.
So, okay, same way, yes, I can, instead of writing D, I can write E multiplied with 1 minus B. B is the retention ratio.
Yes, sir.
Is it not? So, E multiplied with 1 minus B divided by, I told you, KE minus G. But what is G? G is equal to B into R.
Yes, sir.
Is it not? So, formula may appear to be different. When you see the textbook, when you see the study material, formula may appear to be different. But you have if you have understood the concept, concept is that price is the present value of a growing perpetuity. That is the concept. Now, we have to find out how to compute the present value of a growing perpetuity. First, you have to find out what is perpetuity. Perpetuity is the dividend. Dividend is E into 1 minus B. Okay. Divided by KE minus G. G is equal to B into R. Okay. P is the market price per share. E is the earning per share. B is the retention ratio. 1 minus B is the dividend payout ratio. KE is the capitalization rate or cost of capital. B into R is the growth rate. Have you understood this formula?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Both of you have understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay, right. Okay. Now, again, as I told you earlier, that Gordon says, Mr. Gordon says, that price is the present value of the future dividend. Okay. This concept also I had explained to you sometime before in some other context. That how come he says that the price is the present value of the future dividend? Okay, that means P0 is equal to present value of the D1 present value
D1.
Plus present value of D2 plus present value of D3 plus present value of D4 like up to Dn because it is n.
Dn.
Or you can say sum of, summation of present value of all future dividends. That is the price.
Yes, sir.
Meaning, indirectly he is saying that an investor is expecting only dividends. He is not expecting in price. Expecting any price appreciation. Is it not? That means when you are expecting, when you are investing money, are you expecting only dividend? If you are expecting only dividend, then this concept is right. That whatever price you are paying, that is the present value of future dividends. But practically, investors expect two things. One, dividend plus price appreciation.
Price appreciation.
Is it not? Now, question arises or someone may argue, then where is that price appreciation factor? Okay, why Mr. Gordon has not considered this? That question arises, is it not?
Yes.
To understand that thing, let me explain you this concept with the help of one more example. I might have explained you earlier, but still at the cost of repetition, let me explain you that thing. Let us see this chart. Are you familiar with this chart? Isko pehle aapko dikhaya tha kya?
Yes, sir.
A picture?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, still we'll repeat it quickly. My point is that suppose an investor is investing at time period 0. So, right now, let us say you are investing. Right? So, you are paying P0.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, let us say you are a short-term investor. You are investing only for 1 year. Right? After 1 year, you will dispose of the shares. So, when you are paying P0, you are expecting two things. P0 you are paying because you are expecting D1. After 1 year, you will be getting first year's dividend plus P1. So, this is your outflow.
Yes,
you will be getting two things. Dividend you will be getting plus price you will be getting. So, you are getting P, D1 plus P1. Is it not?
Yes, sir.
I can say P0 is equal to present value of D1 plus P1. Right?
Yes, sir.
But when you are disposing of the share, someone is buying that share at P1. After 1 year, he will be buying that share at P1 at price 1, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
When he will buy, he is expecting D2 and P2. Let us say he is also a short-term investor. He is expecting D2 plus P2.
Yes, sir.
Right? And when someone, when he is selling at P2, someone else is buying at P2. He is expecting D3 plus P3. And when the person is buying at P3, he is expecting D4 plus P4. Like this,
P4.
Like this, we can extend up to Dn plus Pn. Is it not? Now, If I put it into a formula, if I convert this thing into a formula to arrive at the present value of the share price, I can say P0 is equal to present value of D1 plus P1. Is it not?
Yes, sir.
But what is P1? P1 is the D2 plus P2. So I can replace P1. I can strike out P1. I can say D2 plus P2.
Yes, sir.
Then I guess, what is P2? P2 can be replaced with D3 plus P3. P3 can also be replaced with D4 plus P4. Like this, you can say price can always be substituted with the next year's dividend plus next year's price. Or I can say P0 is equal to D1's present value plus D2's present value plus D3's present value plus D4's present value plus D5's present value up to Dn's present value. And the last price will never arise because it is a perpetuity.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And the company also having a perpetual successor. It's a perpetuity. So therefore, what Mr. Gordon says, that price is the present value of the future dividends. Understood the logic? If someone asks you why prices has not been taken care of in this formula, that is the logic. Okay. Now, what I explained you,
yes,
the same concept, that means same concept that investor investing in year one expects D1 plus B1 like this. The same concept has been explained in this particular slide. You can read this. Okay. But finally, we have to conclude that price is the present value of the future dividends.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Right. Now, coming back to again Gordon's model. Gordon, since it's a dividend relevant model, or we have also understood that the price is totally function of dividend. So dividend is definitely relevant, is it not? Without dividend, I cannot compute the price. Is it not?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now you see. So he says dividend has got a bearing on the market price of the shares. And here also, Mr. Gordon recommends something which is very similar to Mr. Walter. So according to Gordon also, that when R is more than the KE, then price per share increases. When dividend payout decreases. If R is more than KE, that means firm is earning a rate of return which is more than the shareholder's expectation. If that is the kind of situation, if you pay less dividend, then price will go up. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So when the dividend payout ratio decreases, price increases. And reverse happens when R is less than KE. R is less than KE. What will happen? That means rate of return of the company is less than the expectation of the shareholders. So when you only if you want to increase the price, you have to increase the dividend also. Is it not?
Yes.
And when R is equal to KE, price remains unchanged irrespective of any kind of payout ratio. Okay. So suggestions are also same.
Sir, just
like
sir, when R is less than K, तो उस टाइम पे कैसे प्राइस शेयर प्राइस इंक्रीज हो सकता है उसका रिवर्स केस में जब R is more than K, in that case the share price is decrease increasing also. ता रिवर्स केस में कैसे ये भी इंक्रीज कर सकता है ये तो डिक्रीज होना चाहिए
सर यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट दिस पॉइंट
यस सर
दिस पॉइंट व्हेन R is less than K price per share increases at the dividend payout increases. So your point is that how price can increase?
That should be decrease.
Okay. No. You see, that should be decrease. Normally that should be decrease, but if you want to increase it, you have to pay more dividend. That is what the point is saying. Normally you see, when R is less than KE, R is less than KE means what? Say, let us say shareholders are expecting 20%, but company is earning at 18%. Is it not? Shareholders are expecting 20,
yes,
but company is earning as 18%. Whether shareholders will be satisfied?
No.
You will not be satisfied. So what we'll do? You'll sell the shares.
Yes, sir.
Is it not? You'll try to sell the shares. Okay. When you start selling shares or the investors start selling shares, then price should decrease. Is it not?
Yes, sir.
That is why
yes,
you are saying logically that price should decrease because investors are dissatisfied, price should decrease. How come price should increase?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Right. But yes, that is the time what the company should do. Company should pay now extra dividend. Suppose normally companies should have paid, or similar kind of companies are paying 10% dividend. This company will pay 15% dividend. When dividend is higher, then you who are supposed to sell the share, you will not sell the share. You will retain the
company
share.
Company kahan se cash laega? The extra dividend payment ke liye.
Kahan se laega? Out of its profit. Out of its profit might...
Profit to kam ho raha hai.
Profit kam ho raha hai. Who told you? Not necessary.
Sir, retention is less than the cost of equity.
Which one?
Here written that rate of return is less than cost of equity.
Yes, rate of return is less than cost of equity, but still there is sufficient profit to pay dividend. The decision is that whatever profit is there, out of that how much dividend should be paid. Right. Now, whatever dividend is there, let us say other firm is maintaining, let us say paying less dividend. But here we have to pay more dividends so that price can increase. Okay. Within the profit, whatever profit is available, out of that, maximum dividend should be paid. If possible, 100% dividend should be paid. So that price will start increasing. Are you getting?
लेकिन पहला केस में तो जब R is greater than K ही होता है तब share price increase होता है, फिर इसका reverse केस में कैसे ये same हो सकता है?
Try to understand once again the situation. When R is more than KE, okay, the price per share will increase if the dividend payout decreases. मतलब if dividend decreases, then shareholders will be still happy, price will go up. Okay, we'll test it with the help of example. Examples are there, we'll test it, then we'll say how it is possible. It is possible. It will happen like this. Okay. And if R is less than K, okay, price per share increases. When dividend payout increases. Meaning if you decrease the dividend payout, then price will further decrease. But if you increase the dividend price, now dividend payout, price will further increase. These terms are relative terms. And try to understand, this is one particular theory. This theory believes like this, and this with the data available, this theory proves that this happens. We'll see the proof also. Okay. And if you, for some reason, you don't agree with this, let us say you don't agree, doesn't matter. One more theory is also there, that is dividend irrelevant theory. That dividend doesn't relevant. Okay. So what happens in this kind of financial management subject? There are different theories out there, which talk about different issues and different situations. And you cannot say that this theory is absolutely right and that theory is absolutely wrong. In a given situation, a particular theory may fit, and other situation, another theory may fit. Okay. And this theory's concept is that if R is less than K, then price per share increases as dividend payout increases. Okay. Are you satisfied?
Yes.
Still, when we'll solve the question, you'll be able to find out how it is happening. We'll be solving some questions shortly. So now, finally, we have to come to this kind of conclusion. If R is more than KE, payout ratio should be zero. Right? If R is equal to KE, there is no optimum ratio. When R is less than KE, then optimum payout ratio is 100%. Firms should 100. Pay maximum dividend to the extent possible so that at least to some extent share prices can go up. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, with that background, let us solve this question. Okay. Please read the question.
Determine the market price of a share of LMN LTD given that cost of equity is equals to 11%, earning per share is 20 rupees, R is 12%, 11%, 10%. The market price be determined if B is equals to 90% or B is equals to 60% and B is equals to 30%.
Okay, we'll solve this question and we'll be analyzing, as you are saying, if what will happen if the payout ratio increases. Share price should increase or share price should decrease. It depends upon the situation. In fact, the question says cost of equity is 11%, that is fine. Earning is rupees 20, that's also fine. And there are the three possibilities of return. It may be 12%, maybe 11%, maybe 10%. All the three things we have to consider while solving the question. And the whatever the market price, again, there are three possibilities that if B means what? B means retention ratio, right? B is 90%. Yes. That means retention is 90%. Retention is 90% means payout is
10%.
10%. Second case is B is 60%. That means what is payout?
40%.
And B is 30%. What is payout?
70%.
So with that kind of payout ratio, there are three possibilities. And return on equity has got these possibilities, 12%, 11%, 30%. We have to solve the question. Understood the question? I will be giving you the format, then we will be answering the question. Format is like this, you know, price is equal to E into 1 minus B
into 1
divided by KE minus PR. First we will solve, yes. If R is 12% and B is 90%.
Yes, sir.
Can you solve the question? E, you know, E is 20 rupees. E is 20 rupees. Okay. And cost of equity is 11%. Pen, yes, and paper is ready with you, pen paper calculator.
Yes, sir.
Let us solve this question. E is rupees 20. KE is 11%. We have to calculate the price. First option, R is 12% and B is
90%.
Under the heading R is 12%, first of all, B is 90%. Can you calculate what is the price of this? Should I help you?
No, sir. We are doing.
You are doing?
It is coming 1000.
Very good. Exactly. You see, it is coming 1000. Okay. Now check the answer. When B is 60%. Are you getting the answer?
210.5263.
Right. The third question we'll do, when B is 30%.
$189.89.
Okay. Meghna,
you got the answers?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now you see. Now you try to understand. R is how much? 12%. K is how much? 11%. That means R is more than KE situation.
Yes, sir.
Is it not? This is R is more than KE situation. If that is the situation, if you see, when I have retention is 90%. Okay, that means payout is 10%. When payout is 10%, value is 1000. When payout is 40%, retention is 60%, payout is 40%. and payout is 40%. That means हम लोग जो ज्यादा दे रहे हैं, जो 10% दे रहे थे, when you are paying 10%, price was 1000. When I am paying 40%, price was 210. When I am paying 70%, price is 189. That means when I am paying less, price is increasing. When I am paying more, increasing. Price is decreasing.
Yes, sir.
Understood? When R is 12%. Understood? So that is the concept. First aspect of the theory is proof. Okay. Second, you will see if R is exactly 11%. R is 11%, then what will happen? R is 11%, K is also 11%. So you can find out, first case P is, if I pay 90%, price is 181. If I pay 60%, price is 181. If I pay 30%, price is also 181. That means it is indifferent.
Yes, sir.
Yes, understood? Sir. This is the situation when R is equal to K. Right? Third situation we'll see, R is 10%. That means R is less than KE situation. Okay. And here if you see, if I retain 90%, that means pay 10%, price is 100. Check these calculations. See if the calculations are correct. Are you agreeing? Price
is 100.
And when I'm retaining 60%, retaining 60% means how much I'm paying?
40.
When I'm paying 40%. That means I am paying more, right? I am paying more and you see prices are more. That means, as you are saying, if I want to increase the price, I have to pay more dividend. Okay, understood now? So, Rajan, yes, you are asking this question, yes, how it is possible, yes, how price can increase? Price can increase if I pay more, if I retain less. Here I am retaining less. Actually, I am retaining 90%, but here I am retaining 60%. If I pay further more, that means I am paying 70%, retaining only 30%. You see, price has gone up to 175. That's the proof.
Yes, sir.
Are you getting?
Yes, sir.
Okay. These questions you can try once again at home. You'll be able to understand. Okay. I think up to this concept, we are quite clear. Now, we'll quickly cover the impact of dividend growth model. And this impact will be understanding under three headings. Okay. But by this time, we have indirectly have already covered this aspects. Just it is a kind of summarization of the impacts which you have already learned. First, we see it's a situation when the normal capitalization rate is less than the actual capitalization rate. So here we are considering two aspects. One is, what is the normal capitalization rate? Normal capitalization rate, for your understanding, will think that is the what is the normal shareholder's expectation? Normally you should capitalize at that rate. Or you can say that is something similar with KE. And what is actual capitalization rate? Actual capitalization rate means the capitalization rate of the company. That means company's earning. Okay. When I say normal capitalization rate is less than actual capitalization rate, what I'm exactly talking about, that KE is less than R.
R. Yes, sir.
KE is less than R. That means shareholders' expectations are less. But company is earning more. If that is the situation, shareholder gains it. Making investment in that company. Shareholder will be happy to make investment because company's earnings are higher.
Yes, sir.
Okay. In that situation, then shareholders also would like that firm should retain maximum dividend. Firm should not pay dividend. Firm should retain the profit. Because firm is growing at a higher rate. Okay.
Yes, sir.
But next situation will say that normal capitalization rate is equal to actual capitalization rate. If that is the kind of situation, the shareholders are indifferent to any level of dividend. Whatever dividend you pay, shareholders are happy with that, equally happy with that. And if the normal capitalization rate is more than the actual capitalization rate, that means shareholders are expecting more or the market is expecting more. equity market is expecting more, but actually shareholders are getting less. So that is a kind of declining situation. That means company for some reason is unable to satisfy the shareholders or unable to earn that much of profit. If the company is unable, then at least the company should try to pay maximum dividend to the shareholders. So let shareholders independently decide how to invest that money. So
yes,
shareholders will expect to get maximum dividend in that kind of situation. Okay. This is the impact on the shareholders' expectation and the impact on dividend. Okay, so this is how three things we have understood, three more concepts. Okay, now quickly, I would like that we should solve one more question. Right, now please, some of you please read this question.
Good.
A company has a total investment of 5 lakh in asset and 50,000 outstanding common share of rupees 10 per share. It earns a rate of 15% on its investment and has a policy of retaining 50% of its earning. If the appropriate discount rate of the firm is 10%, determine the price of share using Gordon model. And what will happen to the price of share if the company has a payout of 80% or 20%?
Okay, so let me explain you that question. Company has the total investment of 5 lakh. So asset worth is 5 lakh.
Yes.
Okay. So yes, equally, sir, that should be represented by the equal amount of equity or liability. And that is divided with 50,000 outstanding common shares of rupees 10. So 50,000 into 10, that's also 5 lakh, isn't it? So that is, again, it's an all equity firm, no debt, entire equity. Asset is this one, equity is this one. And shares are issued at par value, that also, that this has been confirmed by the question. Achha, it adds a rate of return of 15% on its investment. That means, what is this 15%?
R.
R, very good. This is R, company's internal rate of return. And has the policy of retaining 50%. So 15% is what? Retention ratio.
Sorry, sir.
And has the policy of retaining 50%. That 50%, what we'll call it in the formula?
Is B.
B. B. B. What, Meghna, you are saying?
Sir, I say E.
E is the total earning. Okay, but it is B. B means how much is retained, right? If the appropriate discount rate of the firm is 10%, okay, determine the price of share using Gordon's model. So we'll address that issue once I will explain you. I will give you the format how to solve the question. At that time, we'll be understanding what is the relevance of this 10%. Okay. So, what is now coming to your mind? What is this 10% in the formula?
Discount rate.
Discount rate means?
R.
R is 15%, you have understood, no?
No, sir. Matlab, present value.
Present value is to be discounted. But present value, you try to understand. Present values are discounted at cost of equity, at the cost of capital. Okay, so here we are talking about the 10%, we are talking about this is the cost of capital. Okay.
Sir, I didn't get it.
Discount rate means cash. We discount the future cash flows. We discount the future
cash flows
at cost of capital. And here cost of capital means KE.
Yes,
right. So 10% is KE and 15% is the R.
R.
Okay. So that is the situation.
Yes,
so R is more than KE situation in that question. What will happen in the price of the share if the company has payout ratio of 80%, 20%? Now, I will give you the structure how to solve the question. Now, I will be explaining you this thing. Later at your home, you can practice this question. Okay, no need to solve right now, but let us learn it. So company's income is how much? We know company earns at 15%.
Yes, sir.
So 15% of the 5 lakh is its investment. On its investment, company will earn 15%. That means 75,000 company will earn. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And the question says, company has the policy of retaining 50%. So, out of this 75%, 50% will be retained. So,
yes,
distribution, how much will be distributed? 37,500. Understood?
Yes, sir. Yes,
and 37,500 will be distributed, and we have 50,000 shares. Question has made it clear. Is it not?
Yes, sir.
So, my earning per share, if I see, my earning, this is my earning. Earning per share is equal to 75,000 divided by 50,000 is equal to 1.5. And my dividend per share or DPS is equal to 37,500 divided by 50,000 is equal to 0.75. So this is my EPS, this is my DPS. Okay?
Yes, sir.
What is growth? Growth is B into R, you know. And the normal, it says retention is 50%. That is 0.5 into 15%. So, 0.075 is the growth. If I know all these factors, I can very well compute that P0 is equal to D1 by KE minus G is equal to 0.75 divided by KE is 0.10 cost of equity minus 0.075 is equal to 30. Okay, growth rate will be again less than KE. This is one of the assumptions of this particular model we have seen. Otherwise, this formula will give a different result, absolute result. So, therefore, that assumption has been taken so that we can deduct KE minus G. Growth can be deducted from KE. In that assumption, we have taken one assumption. No, KE is more than G. No. If payment is 80%, 80%, similarly, you can calculate EPS is same, 1.8, but DPS will be 1.2 and growth will be 0.03 and price will be 17.14. Price will decrease.
Yes, sir.
If payment is more. If payment is less, suppose I am paying 20%. 20%. Okay. Then what will happen? You see the situation.
Yes,
DPS will be this much. Growth will be 12%. You see, growth will be 12%. Since growth will be 12%, we cannot apply this formula. So, KE minus G, that means 10% minus 12%. Since this is against the basic assumption, the value of the share cannot be computed, or the price of the share cannot be computed by using this model, because assumptions are not valid. Understood the third situation?
Yes, sir.
Because KE minus G, I will not be able to come. Okay, this question, you can see it from the recorded video. You can see it and try to understand this question. This is again a conceptual question. And here the only catch is that you have to understand the importance of the assumptions. If assumption is not valid, then the price cannot be computed. This is the third case it shows. Okay, lastly, in this chapter, we have a new concept has been subsequently added to the Gordon's theory. Right? Almost you have seen the Gordon's theory and Walter's theory, both of them suggest a similar kind of thing. That means the return on equity and the firm's cost of capital needs to be compared, and accordingly decision can be taken that how much dividend should be paid, what should be the dividend policy. But subsequently what happened? Gordon has revised his basic model, and he has introduced the concept of risk into that model. Okay, he have tried to understand or he had tried to incorporate the concept of the risk, which was ignored in the earlier model, which you have learned till now. Till now, you have learned a simple model, which is more or less similar to Walter's model. Okay, but some differences are there. Gordon assumes growth in dividend, Walter doesn't assume growth in dividend. Like this, some kind of differences are there. But you have understood in the both the theories, they suggest one thing. When R is more than KE, then we have understood that any kind of dividend is good. Is it not?
Yes, sir.
When R is KE, then you can give any kind of dividend. Okay, that means there is nothing called as optimal payout ratio. There is nothing called as optimum payout ratio, because R is equal to KE, anything can be paid.
Equal to KE. Okay. Yes, sir.
Now to address this particular challenge, to address this particular issue, Gordon modified the theory, and he said, okay, we'll incorporate risk in that kind of situation. He says, investors are risk averse. That means normally investors do not want to take any kind of risk. They would like to pay premium on certain return. If the return is certain, return is 100% sure, they would like to pay more price. And they would like to discount or penalize if uncertain return. If the return is doubtful, then they will not pay more price. They would like to discount the price. Okay. Premium should be paid if the return is certain, and discount should be charged if return is uncertain. Is it not?
Yes, sir.
And he says, when we are retaining the profit, when the retention ratio is high, that means shareholders' income is uncertain. That means shareholders will receive that return, but in a future day, which is uncertain. Is it not? But
yes,
when
you
are paying more means it is certain. It is coming to the shareholders' hand. Therefore, he says that bird in hand, that means one bird in hand is more than two in the bush. Bird which is under in your hand, that is already under your control. That means this particular concept, this particular argument says that always it is better to have the certain return, or always it is better to have a quick dividend rather than postponing it for the future debt and treating it like a retained earning kind of thing. Okay. Now this theory says, if we consider risk, then investors will prefer current return or near dividend rather than future dividend. Retained earnings are future dividend. So if risk aspects have to be considered, in the R equal to KE situation, even in that situation also, the company should pay more dividend. Why pour more dividend? Because investors do not want to take risk. Investors want to take less risk. Investors want some kind of quick money. They don't want to wait for future. Is it not?
Yes, sir.
So that is equivalent to the situation, or that is equivalent to the concept or proverb that we talked, that a bird in hand, one bird in hand is equal to two in the bush. It is something similar to that. So this is, you can say, modification or a kind of addition to the Walter's theory, which is very relevant considering the risk element, a risk aspect. Okay. So friends, with this, we are computing this particular model, Gordon's model. So we'll again catch up with your next class, maybe tomorrow. I'll be intimating you. In that class, we'll be entering into the new theory, that is MM's model or MM's theory. Okay, if you have any query, then raise it right now, or later on you can WhatsApp me, you can speak to me, so that I'll be able to cover it in our next class. Okay, any query you have for the time being?
No.
No, sir.
Okay, so thank you very much. We'll catch up in our next class. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.